Alright guys, Hack here. A little bit of a special edition this time. Well, they're all kind of special to me, but this is something I've been meaning to do for a while here. This is the Skaven Doomwheel. It's a great model, great sculpt, a lot of fun to do, and really not that difficult if you have the right tools and know-how. But before we can get on to the Doomwheel itself, we need to do the base. Now, I've found that GW does some very simple bases, and we're going to do a very simple base because the Doomwheel is so busy, making a busy base may be a little too much. So just really two things here. It's, well, three things. It's going to be a grass. We'll get to that later. But sand and a ballast. I'm using a decorative sand here that you get in a hobby shop, but it basically counts as a ballast. No real secrets here, but this is something we're going to use right here. This is a cheap acrylic paint that I got at, you know, any old store for like a dollar or something. Because you don't want to use your good paint on such, especially such a big base. You know, you end up going through a quarter pot of paint or something like that, and you're going to need a lot. So always put down the bigger grit first, because if you put down the smaller grit, you're going to cover up all the glue and nothing for the bigger grit to stick through. So always biggest and then work your way down. At least in most cases, unless you're gluing a big rock on or something like that. I think we all know how to sprinkle sand on top of a base with glue on it. Just make sure you pat it down at the very end to make sure you got a good, you know, it seals in there good, sticks good. And then go ahead and get that cheap stuff and mix it down with water. You want to thin it, but not too thin. You want it to still be somewhat pasty. Thinner than white glue, but definitely not watery, because you're going to layer it on and it's going to act as a glue itself and make sure everything sticks to the base and nothing comes up. All right. So when this stuff dries, it's very dark. We got to lighten it up. Okay. And the way we're going to do this is we're going to do a series of dry brushes, but only the very last dry brush is actually going to be the highlights. Everything else is just modifying the color. So I start off here with some steel legion drab, we're going to again, this is just a change of color on it. And then after that, I'm going to come in with a little bit of Xandri dust, which I just picked up right there, and we're going to do the same thing. Again, this is not a highlight. This is just to kind of change the color, pick out a little things. Yes, it does look a little bit lighter. But it really doesn't change anything. In normal light, when you're seeing this, you're going to be like, that's not really a highlight. That just kind of makes it look a little dusty, which is kind of what you want, okay? Again, subtle effect. And the last thing I do is I take a little ivory, and I put ivory down. And since I already have, you know, the different type of browns inside my dry brush, it's going to not be a pure white. It's going to be a little bit more of an off-white, sorry, ivory, but a little bit more of an off-white on the brown hue. And this is your actual highlight. This is the only highlight. Now, it looks a little, again, lighting may not be great, but when you see the pictures at the end and stuff, you'll really be able to pick out how this worked. Anyway, throw some glue down, dip it in some static grass. I think I use brown in this case. Put a tuft or two here or there. And you have a nice, simple base that will really complement a very complex and busy looking model. And that's basically it. I just went anywhere because I want some of the grass to be coming out from under the Doomwheel as well. So, all right, so let's move on to the model itself. Okay, so this model has four basic components or color schemes. You have wood, you have the metal frame, you have the Skaven itself, and then you have the piping. So here I use Rhinox High and a little bit of burnt umber, and this puts down a very nice, warm, hued, dark brown. The recesses inside of this Doomwheel, meaning the sculpt, is pretty deep, so this will kind of act as a wash. I don't actually do a wash, I do a glaze, we'll get to that a little bit later, but we do the wash. We just do that, and then we come with a dry brush here. Now I'm using XV88, and this is another very warm color. It's not real bright, but it's, you know, it looks real nice, and it contrasts a little bit with the Rhinox hide to really give you that kind of like that deep oak look. It's that real, you know, thick oak. It's it looks old and weathered. Don't be shy about the dry brush, okay? Just really go ahead and get into it. Again, the recesses in the sculpt are deep enough that, you know, you're not going to hit that. You're really going to see two colors when you dry brush. You can see the XP88 on the top, and then you're going to see the base, you know, underneath it. So once you get done dry brushing everything, make sure you get all of it, okay, everything that's wood. Go ahead and pop this stuff off the side and get ready for the metal frame. Now I'm going to airbrush the entire thing because it's kind of a lot. There's a lot of flat surfaces. I guess you don't have to, just really have to thin down your paints. But when you do, use a dark metallic color, dark silver. Here I'm using gun gray mixed with black, at least 1:1, even a little bit more on the black. Remember, the darker that you make your metallics, the better the highlighting works. Set it off to the side once you get everything done, and then start in on the piping and the warp stones. So I based everything Calvin Green, and I'm doing a lot of airbrushing here because really this is the only color that really pops the entire model, so I want to have those nice bright transitional effects on the piping, on the warp stones, and it gives a really nice effect overall when you do it. So again, just building up highlights, and I'm going to be dry brushing the actual warp stones themselves. So again, start with a barely above the Calvin Green. Okay, this is going to sound a little weird, but don't have a really, really dry brush and just go a million times over it. That gives you that chalky effect. Have a light hand, and even use the side of the brush, I found, does a pretty good job as well. Don't, you know, do it so much that you start getting, you know, the paint into the recesses and whatnot. You know, kind of go easy. Take your time when you go on it. But again, don't be afraid, you know, to have a little bit of extra paint on this. Just be careful. And then I'm building up moot green, and then I'm going to mix the moot green with white for the dry brush. Again, this is a good sculpt, so you should be pretty safe here. And I've actually oversprayed a little bit on the inside, as you may be able to see. Kind of hard to see unless you're looking at in normal daylight, but it gives a source light effect as well. And I kind of did that anywhere where the warp stone was at. For the white and the moot green, I only concentrated on the very tips of the warp stone to really kind of accent the end pieces of that. That was very intricate. Oh, by the way, the little devices there that have the warp stones, and I seem to have lost one. I don't know where it's in. It's probably underneath my chair somewhere. Anyway, I will actually show you the pictures of it missing. I'll order another one and pop it on there or something like that to complete the model. But it's not a mistake. Well, losing it's a mistake, but not showing it on there. I didn't forget to put it on. I just don't know where it went. Again, the final highlighting here with all these little pieces, especially where it connects to the metal. I did extra highlighting there to kind of set it apart. Again, this is kind of the centerpiece as far as color scheme goes, this green, so it's okay to be a little loud with it. And it gives an overall real nice effect. So we're going to be moving on here to the Skaven himself, the driver, which incidentally took me probably just as much time to do the driver as it did the rest of the model. So I've already gone in and done the base coat with the dark silver. And I'm going to come back in. I'm going to start on all the cloth. So I picked the scheme. I looked online. I picked Skaven iconography and found a clan out there to make sure it's somewhat within canon. And it's a red scheme, so just like the other Skaven I've done. So I just go ahead and I start with corn red and build up with the highlight. You know, half corn red, half red from Vallejo model color, all the way up until I get to like an orange type color. Again, I'm not doing edge highlights. I'm trying to blend everything. Even the very edges are trying to blend in. The end effect is more subtle, and I think especially up close, a lot more pleasing to the eye. So again, this little sucker took me a long time to get done. He's pretty intricate, and I did a little potion right there. Came out nice. So we're going to move on to actually the glazing of the wood. And I say glaze because it's not meant to be a wash, it's meant to be a glaze. So I start off with Vallejo game color washes, which, as I've said before in the past, they're more like a glaze. And I add to that some umber shade to each one as well. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to start coming in with different colors. I mostly use Minotaur, so I'm going to use Minotaur red, green, and brown. Just one drop per the seven drops because the stuff is really strong. There needs to be black in it because you still want to get the recesses highlighted. And if you just use all red, it's not going to have a good effect. So you need to have black and brown in the primary wash. And there goes the green, and then I do brown. And for the last one, I do some normal Seraphim Sepia from Citadel. It's a lighter color, so it's going to be all right, and not really drown anything out like a lot of Citadel washes do. By the way, again, this has to be a glaze because you did all the highlighting, the dry brushing with the XV88. If you went in with a standard wash, you would kill that highlight. You'd never be able to see it. Again, we're looking for a nice, deep, oaken type of tone, but I can't have every single plank be the same. Well, you can, but it's going to be a much nicer effect if you change it around. So I just want some randomness on that because everything is plank. The little wheel, the big wheel, and there's like a board on the back a little guy sits on, and I did that as well. So what you're going to do is you're going to glaze every single plank with this mixture here. And then once you get done, and make sure it dries all the way. This Minotaur stuff takes a while to dry, and that's okay. Then go in with a straight glaze. Only once this is 100% dry, again, the mix is dry, then go ahead and go in with the straight green from Minotaur and just do a glaze on over, obviously the same one, over the green that you did before. And that's going to highlight the colors a little bit more and give it a really, really nice effect. And you can see here at the end as I'm doing the final glazes, you can tell each board came from a different place, sort of speak, looking. And anyway, it just turned out real nice. Again, it's a little detail that really makes the difference in doing a model that's, you know, again, it's this complex, so might as well go the extra mile to really make it look nice in the end. All right, so assembly time, at least the beginning of assembly, and this thing's not fun to assemble. It can be a little finicky. Especially the driver in the middle. Make sure you read the instructions and you do it in the order it tells you to do, because if you go out of order, it ain't going to fit. And I kind of found that the hard way in at least one piece here. Generally speaking, it fits together pretty good. It's got a little bit of gaps here and there. You have to paint it when it's in pieces, so going back in and filling those gaps and repainting is probably a little bit more than I really care to do. The last step is just going to be the rats here, they're inside the wheel. Take a little bit of time with them. I think there's six rats per little thing here, and I picked six different colors. You know, it's a shame to do all this work and just to have your rats be kind of vanilla, if you will. So then it's assembly time. I'm not going to give away too much assembly because this thing, when it comes together, it's really neat when it comes together. It's very satisfying to actually put this thing together and actually start getting those wheels together and slap the wheel onto the main frame and all that kind of stuff. It's a lot of fun. I got to finish the little guy up in the back here. And again, he was done basically in the same skin as his partner up front. No big secret here, but just again, he's out in this open, so take some time with him. And you can do him when he's put together. So the banner is quite the centerpiece of this miniature. So keep him in the scheme of how it was. Again, red. I start off with a whole red, which is a very, very dark red. It was already primered black, and it's going to act kind of as a black. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to start layering up and going through my paint scheme, starting with corn red. And here I'm just doing this basic highlighting, but you'll see I start doing kind of on each one of those folds, I'm going to start doing the upper right-hand corner as you're looking at it for a highlight. And the reason is, a lot of these, you know, banners that I saw, they had so much stuff going on that it kind of filled up the banner. And I really didn't want to make a real busy banner with a lot of little stuff on it, do tons of stenciling. I wanted to be kind of simple. So in order to make sure the banner itself has good appeal, I made sure it was highlighted in such a way that looked really nice. And again, we're just doing, you know, kind of the five-step process, you know, the base color, then the base color first highlight one-to-one, and then pure the first highlight. And you just keep on doing that until you get all the way up to just pure Troll Slayer orange, and do the final highlights again, very, very little bit. And it ends up being a really nice banner. But we need to have iconography on there as well. This particular clan has iconography. I'm sure they don't sell transfers for, but even if they did, there's something about the transfer. It's too clean. It's too perfect. It doesn't go along all the time very well. So I'm going to do freehand. Now, how do you do freehand? First, you pick the symbol you're going to do. Make sure it's the same scale. Draw it out by freehand. And then you're going to, now that you have a reference of how big it needs to be and whatnot, you're just going to put it right on there. I know it's a little bit daunting because you just spent all this time doing this Doomwheel, and the last thing you want to do is screw it up by, you know, ruining that wonderful banner with, you know, freehand. But there's a trick. It's not so much of a trick, but we're going to start off with a micro pen, right? You can go out and get these micro pens from anywhere, right? Micro pen. And we're going to draw it first. And you're actually not going to color it in. You're going to draw the outline. So that way, when you draw the outline, there's still a little bit of black kind of on the border on the inside. It frames it all the more and makes it look, makes it look really nice. So a good paintbrush and good, well thin paint is key to this. Better to have more dry paint than wet paint, because if it's too wet and runs off your brush, you can't really wipe that stuff off, especially if you're doing a white like I am here on top of it. Go slow. There's no rush. You're going to have to do a few coats anyway, at least with white you will. And the end result, I think, is a much more, it brings everything together better, and it doesn't look so fake. It looks like you did it, which you would have. So give it a shot, guys. Don't be scared of it. If it's your first time, go on to eBay, buy a few bits for like 99 cents and practice on those bits. Buy a few, you know, banners. There are some Bretonnian banners out there for like $1 per dozen. You know, go ahead and just practice on it before you do the real thing. But you'll like the way it turns out. And here we go, guys. Here's the finished product. The pictures that are to follow have a little bit better of a look to it. Again, the missing piece, I'll find that and glue it on. But there it is, guys. Didn't take me that long. I think it was maybe a 5-hour project. A lot of fun, a real satisfying model to kind of put together. Thanks for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Subscribe below, leave me a comment, and check me out. You guys take care. See you again soon. One could foresee the end that came so fast. Hear the prophet make his gift that paradise lies to the west. So join his quest for the sun. Shades of death are all I see, fragments of what used to be.